Hello and welcome to Movie Night. I'm your host, Jonathan Paula. Back again from another long break to review a major blockbuster on opening day. So let's get right into my spoiler-free thoughts on Star Wars: The Rise of Skywalker. An enjoyable and emotional end to a messy trilogy. Released worldwide on December 20th, 2019, this $250 million film is the purported ninth and final episode in the decades-long Skywalker saga. If franchise trends are any indication, this epic space opera fantasy will likely earn at least $1 billion at the box office. When the evil Emperor Palpatine returns from the dead, the surviving heroes of the Intrepid Resistance mount one last mission to stop the Sith once and for all. In an effort to please everyone, director J.J. Abrams, returning to the Star Wars franchise after directing 2015's The Force Awakens, pulls out all the stops, sometimes perhaps to a detrimental degree. The PG-13 rated adventure proceeds at a breakneck pace, with the 2-hour and 22-minute runtime barely able to contain all of the characters, locations, and action. A little breathing room and fewer new people would have gone a long way. Once again, Daisy Ridley, Adam Driver, John Boyega, and Oscar Isaac lead the cast, and thankfully they're given ample time to shine, and they're finally together on screen for a change, as the previous two entries kept separating these characters. Ridley and Driver need to be singled out as the best part of this entire trilogy. Strong and multifaceted performances dripping with angst and doubt. Their shared conflict and duality is the heart of this picture, and their excellent acting sell it in a big way. They're supported by a massive ensemble that includes the late Carrie Fisher, Mark Hamill, Anthony Daniels, Naomi Ackie, Domhnall Gleeson, Richard E. Grant, Lupita Nyong'o, Kerry Russell, Juno Sutomo, Kelly Marie Tran, Ian McDiarmid, and Billy Dee Williams. Unfortunately, few are afforded enough screen time to make a lasting impact, relying on earlier films to bolster their bona fides. And as for introducing several new characters halfway through the last movie in a 42-year-old franchise, it seems ambitious at best and unnecessary at worst. Unfortunately, it's quite impossible to review this picture in a vacuum, as its relationship with past entries, both recent and original, is intrinsically woven into its identity. But let's start with the former. For all of its divisiveness, Rian Johnson's The Last Jedi was a unique and even challenging film, especially within the confines of a rigorously controlled blockbuster apparatus like Disney. That 2017 entry upended the franchise's status quo with the central thesis that anyone could tap into the Force and become a hero. It was an empowering message of hope and optimism in an increasingly darkening world. I adored it. Seemingly kowtowing to the backlash from a vocal and entitled minority, JJ does an abrupt about-face, retconning or sidelining nearly everything Rian established, sometimes even physically. Driver literally rebuilds his smashed helmet 10 minutes into this movie. This will likely frustrate fans of Jedi and appease its detractors. So rather than following the bold new direction his predecessor laid out, Abrams quickly reframes this final chapter where the saga began, a story about family and lineage. Taken on its own, it's an effective and familiar tack that franchise fans, especially those alienated by Johnson's vision, will undoubtedly love. But given what could have been, it's an unfortunate and constant reminder that a true follow-up to the stirring ideas in The Last Jedi will never exist. And although it doesn't outright ignore the events of that picture, this definitely feels more like a direct sequel to Episode 7, not 8. Individually, all three films in the sequel trilogy are actually quite excellent, but collectively they lack a clear vision. Disney's hodgepodge assembly and pendulum of directors is disheartening to see for this lifelong fan. To put it bluntly, the sequel trilogy is a complete mess. It's amazing it worked at all. Besides the narrative course correcting, Abrams also had to navigate around the passing of Carrie Fisher. While declaring her character dead in the space crawl and opening the film on her funeral would have been an easy and arguably better solution, her character remains very much alive at the start of this picture, incorporated sparingly by way of rotoscope and color-matched outtakes from previous films. The result is interesting. Unlike the CGI trickery that brought Paul Walker back to life for Furious 7, this is Carrie's real performance, but all the dialogue around her has been written to fit years-old leftovers, so it feels a bit clunky, especially if you're aware of how it had to have been accomplished. It reminds me of how I insert myself into movies for the opening sketches of Movie Night. It's nice to have her in the film, but it feels more gimmicky than effective. The many locations here are vibrant and fresh, even if the crew of the Millennium Falcon find themselves visiting yet another desert planet. The action and set pieces are all first-rate blockbuster spectacles, making appropriate use of the aforementioned backdrops.
We've spotted the fugitives.
The music from legendary composer John Williams in what will likely be his final Star Wars project is predictably excellent, incorporating leitmotifs from the original films alongside darker versions of Rey's theme, perhaps the most prominent piece from the new trilogy. The humor, often delivered by everyone's favorite annoying protocol droid C-3PO and a new duck-looking robot called Dio, is great at breaking the tension in more serious scenes. Meanwhile, the narrative is stuffed with callbacks and cameos from films past, and some of these surprises work remarkably well. Others are shoehorned in seemingly for convenient nostalgia. But if you're a fan, they'll definitely make you smile. At least I forget the visuals, which blend flawless computer imagery with practical puppet work and realistic sets. If there's one thing every Star Wars movie has consistently nailed, it's production design. Ultimately, the biggest thing I disliked about Episode 9 is how aggressively it ignores nearly everything Episode 8 established. But on its own, this is honestly a wonderful and fulfilling end to the Skywalker saga. Many story beats are sadly predictable, but the catharsis of finally seeing them all unfold is a true delight. The last scene is an emotional return to the series' humble beginnings, a beautiful capstone to a cinematic institution. I couldn't help but cry. These lasting final images ensure you'll leave the theater on a bittersweet high, but upon more intellectual reflection, deeper flaws do become apparent. The Rise of Skywalker returns to comfort and familiarity in a rousing, if unchallenging, send-off. This is a really great film, and I'd place it somewhere in the middle of the 11-picture franchise. As this decade and 10 years of Movie Night comes to a close, I just want to share my heartfelt appreciation and thanks for everyone that's ever watched my content, especially if you're still watching it. I regret not being able to upload as often as I'd like, but with my second daughter due any week now and a full-time job to attend to, YouTube sadly isn't a priority for me anymore. But I'm still very active on social media, so if you're curious about what I've been up to, please follow the links in the description below. And if you want to hear more of my thoughts on film, make sure to visit letterboxd.com/JohnPaula, where I've written 20 reviews in just the last month, including full thoughts on Gemini Man, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, Ad Astra, and many more. While I can't promise anything, I would like to produce a Best and Worst Movies of the Decade video sometime in January, so please subscribe and hit the bell icon so you're notified when that video is uploaded. My name is Jonathan Paula. Have a Merry Christmas, a Happy New Year, and of course, a good movie night.